So, welcome to
Tribeca
Tribeca
Cinemas.
Cinemas, right? And I'm here to answer any questions regarding Zeitgeist moving forward. And I'm here with the Venus Project, our New York chapter coordinator, and you are also our New York chapter coordinator. I'm not sure whether we haven't given categorizations yet, have we?
We're co-coordinators,
Core
Keith and I.
coordinators, very beautiful. That's what I figured as much. And I'm open to any questions you guys have to ask.
The third film is very ambitious and very radical. How do you think that it could become a reality when you step outside into the city and you see the condition? Like, take a city like New York, for instance. You look at the skyline, you look at the people, you look at the piles of trash. How do you think that we can really transition? How realistically speaking, like, what do you think is
Well, there's two angles of transition. There's the physical transition, and then there's the cultural transition. And out of both sides, the latter is much more complex. The physical transition, the rebuilding of buildings, this is all technically feasible. It's provably and scientifically concrete that we can do much more advanced things with extreme high efficiency. So the physical transition isn't a problem to me at all. It's the cultural transition. It's the people that are locked into the systems, the people that identify so dogmatically that they feel that anything that alters their sense of identity is an attack on them. And this often, social systems, people identify with their social systems. They want to believe that their social systems are for them, just like they want to believe that their governments are for them, just like they want to believe that marketing and advertising or corporations like Apple Computer has a huge following of people that identify strongly. Same thing goes for a corporation and social system. So we have the free market, we believe in freedom and democracy, and these words have resonant meanings with people, whatever you want to define them as. That's a whole different subject because of the ambiguity of what people have been conditioned to believe those words mean. Point being, the cultural transition is by far the most difficult. We have to educate people on what it means to be sustainable and get them to understand the need to identify with that for their own purposes and the reasoning of their own survival, the survival of their kids and their grandkids. To give a more concrete definition of time span or technical transition, once you have enough people that believe in this, then you begin to slowly change certain environments and certain regions to more sustainable practices not only regarding the industry, but also what people actually do. What people actually engage in. And then slowly the systems will shift, and then hopefully that will spread. One more thing I'll add, though, is that there will be a social breakdown, which has already been underway for many decades, which people don't seem to reconcile, they don't really pay attention to it, such as the continual doubling of poverty, the tremendous suffering, the extreme class division, the onslaught of all sorts of mental diseases, neuroses, and many things covered in the film as a result, literally, of this system. These things are eventually going to come to a head where people will step back and finally say, we can't do this anymore. This is affecting all of our health. We're suffering tremendously on multiple levels. We have energy deficiencies, we have health deficiencies. And all of these things will come to a head to an effect where I think eventually, slowly, it will permeate most consciousness and people will wake up and realize that we have to do something new. Either that happens or we're going to move into something much, much worse, frankly.
Right. And that's, I think, the area that I'd like to talk about. How then would the movement encourage people to
Get in front of that.
Get in front of that or get behind it?
I feel I'm big influence. My big influence, I say this, people find it cliche, is the American Civil Rights Movement, because it actually did work to a certain effect. It was allowed to work, if you will, because of the fact that so many people got behind it. The power is in critical mass. I don't believe that
Always.
Politicians will do anything. To get into a position of political power, you have to navigate a certain path that automatically creates a void for challenging the system, to put it in a long-winded sense. You have to orient the status quo to even be in a position to have a relationship with the status quo. That's just the inevitable motion. You can't possibly have any, and if they do get in power, something will remove them from it, and that's been historically true, or they're demeaned. And the few people that are in power today, then the Congress of the US, Dennis Kucinich, Ron Paul, that have hints of trying to change things for the better, they get more attacked than any other politician out there. They're stifled in their communication. So the change will not come from any political system, and it certainly won't come from a corporate system. You're not going to see corporations magically try to be actually sustainable because, as they point out in the film, it is mathematically impossible for them to do so. The entire financial system is driven by consumption, and the more consumption, the better. Therefore, sustainability is intrinsically thrown out the window. So, and that's just one facet of it. So the change will come from critical mass of people understanding, people that will hopefully grassroots level through the Zeitgeist Movement chapters globally. It will rise up, it will become dominant in the sense that everyone knows about it, and eventually those institutions, those status quo institutions, will have to step back and say, okay, we can no longer ignore this gigantic global movement. And that will be a peaceful type of interaction. Compromises will be made. And if things, and I'll just add one more thing, if things don't materialize and things continue to get worse and worse and worse, if things don't operate in a relatively rational way, where people are paying attention to each other, where the government say, okay, the United Nations, for example, says, okay, we're going to bring in this new organization to see what they have to say because they have hundreds of millions of people that follow it. If that doesn't happen, then I think certain acts of civil disobedience would be necessary.
Well, they're happening now.
There are, but on a global scale, not country specific. Civil disobedience on a global scale that if any actions are taken, they are presented globally. And this will, I think, one action like that to show that there was a power to do so would rattle this system to such an effect that I think it could be very, very positive to get people to finally want to listen to what we have to say in power.
But you take a look at all the austerity measures, you know, that happened in Europe this past summer, and you see the protests in England, and you see the protests in Greece, and you see all that, and you see it in the media, you see it, you know, the images of the firebombing from the police and the students, like, you know, just the street violence, you know, that's occurring
right.
At an alarming rate all through Europe.
Absolutely.
And nothing is being done.
True.
Nobody cares.
Because
people look at the image and they don't see that it's a problem.
They're getting used to it. They're getting numb to this. What happens in society as the breakdown occurs is people just start to say, oh, that's the way it is. You know, they just say, that's the way it is that we have protests. That's the way it is we have crime, or that's the way it is we have poverty. And generation after generation, it's more that's the way it is, and everyone just slowly accepts it. Eventually, you have 4, 5, 6 billion people, many decades from now, starving. And they'll just say, oh, it's our natural resources. We can't afford, we just don't have enough resources. That's their conditioning to believe. And that's the way it is. So I don't advocate protest at all. I don't believe in war protest in a direct sense. I think it does something. I don't put it down. But I advocate actual action. So you're not going to see the Zeitgeist Movement with signs held up in front of Congress or anywhere in any country. That's not the point. The point is to actually, if there is a need, to actually do something that causes an act. So to give a hypothetical, which I'm not advocating, by the way, to show the power of critical mass, if 50% of the U.S. population decided not to pay income taxes, there's no way the U.S. government could prosecute all of these people.
I completely agree, and I haven't paid income taxes in 10 years.
So point being is critical mass is, once the masses come together and the strategy of divide and conquer is finally nullified, which has been with us for centuries and centuries, that's how you divide, that's how you control people, is divide them. Once the artificial boundaries are overridden by this core necessity of life, the life ground necessity that is talked about, life value analysis that John McMurtry describes, which is essentially implying exactly what the Venus Project is about, then people will come together and realize that we have to work to preserve resources, we have to work to create a stable environment for the benefit of everyone, we have to work to create equality, because of the evidence I've showed by Richard Wilkinson, a stratified, divided society is one of the most unhealthy societies you can possibly have and causes the vast spectrum of disease and illness. It's scientifically proven in that sense, social science. I'm not going to say it's a technical science, but right now, all stratified societies, the more stratified, the worse their health is overall. And that is something that has to be recognized. We can't have a society that is so unhealthy when we know it's unhealthy. And hopefully people will begin to understand that and want to work towards something that actually is in line with nature and align with what it takes to actually have a healthy society.
As far as moving steps forward, like the city, the whole design of the city as it's presented seems really worthwhile, but also perhaps expensive in the first iteration, come in transition from what we've got now into It would be one thing, like, once there's 50 of those cities and people are living in a different mindset in a different system, for those to regenerate is one thing. How do you get the first one? But what can people start doing so it's not purely ideas but practice? Because what people respond to is a better option, an actual better option that they experience as a better experience. Because you win over that many more people because
right.
So it might not be the full city the first time, it might be aspects of it to build at a community level,
sure.
To build towards. So like, I don't know.
I'll wait till the cameras in. I'll respond and
we're
and,
fine.
And I'll tell Jacques the question and he can respond as well.
We're ready to go.
Okay. Yeah. With respect to what communities can do to try and inch towards this type of environment, especially with respect to the city systems, which are an intricate part to, I mean, you can, the depiction of the city system is only one depiction, and I think Jacques Fresco would point out, but it's logical, and it just shows what you would do to make the most efficient, energy efficient, ease of transport, you make things localized. These are very common things, and yes, I do believe that people could do this on a local level in a lo-fi way. That's the term I use, lo-fi, as opposed to the hi-fi technical stuff that we point out. But it doesn't create the real resolution of applying technology in the highest order. That's all that has to be kept in mind. And when it comes to money, you know, Jacques, how much, people always ask, how much will it cost to build your city? What do you say when they ask you that question in the sense of what's relevance of cost? Is it relevant, the cost?
No, it's not. Do we have the resources to do it? I mean the physical resources like trucks to deliver materials, concrete, steel. We have more than enough resources, but we don't have enough money to do it. So if a country goes broke, as long as they have arable land and factories, the factories close because people don't have money to buy anything. And then the factories are taken over by local governments because people don't pay taxes on their physical equipment. So what happens, you get a lot of confusion. And if people have information before the breakdown, they know what to do. During the breakdown, they riot, break windows. This is normal for people that can't eat, do not get enough funding from the government to buy food. They will riot. The government will use the army, the navy, the National Guard to put down the riots. And since I feel most riots will be committed by younger people, so they will make new laws. Everybody has to be in the house by 9 o'clock.
Right.
You understand? I mean, that's what governments always do.
Sure.
It has nothing to do with reason or logic. It has to do with a collapsing system. Now, even the collapsing system, the Chevy company could not compete with the Japanese companies. So they bailed them out. Bailing them out does not mean sustainability.
Right.
If you bail out a company and they can't turn out a better car, electrical car, better than the Japanese, they won't survive. And if they don't survive, the company falls into the hands of the government. The government doesn't know how to use those companies, so you have a lot of riots, confusion, and during the change, many new systems will not work.
Right.
And they'll blame the new system. And the public doesn't know which way to go, so you have what they call social chaos. In order to put down social chaos, you have to use the army, the navy, or the National Guard to put down the chaos. That's called fascism.
Right.
But if you can't pay people, if you can't pay them a wage, which the government won't have the money to do. See, if I were a senator, I would immediately cut my salary in half to show that I care. I haven't heard that yet. I haven't heard the president say, I've got enough to live on, I don't want any salary, let it go to help people.
Or the banks.
And people would identify with them.
Sure.
But banks do not think that way.
No.
Most businesses think in terms of profit.
It will collapse.
Otherwise they wouldn't outsource.
It's really...
Do you understand what I mean? If they cared for the American people. So what they do is they ask people to join the armed services as loyalty. Although they'll get a minimum wage and food and clothing, they will try to get larger armies to maintain control of people. But in the meantime, in Europe, they will respond faster. I mean, because they're having a harder time than we are. So nations will be fighting each other the majority and minority people that are exploited most by the system will be the most active. It's not going to be smooth. I always said the transition will be the most painful thing up ahead, because just fighting for women's rights took a lot of battles, or giving them the right to vote, or getting rid of child labor in factories, you know, that took a long time. And when you have children working for you, you can maintain the competitive edge. If you have to pay a higher salary, you can't maintain the competitive edge. So if you free children, the factory goes broke because they can't maintain the competitive edge. All that industry wants to do is contain and maintain the competitive edge. And if they can't do that, they will use the Army and Navy. They control the Army and Navy, not the wealthy people.
Unfortunately, people aren't wise enough intellectually or emotionally to sit back and look at society and say, what's wrong, where do we need to go in order to maintain a civilization and a future for us. We feel it will take the breakdown, as we talked about, and people losing their jobs, losing confidence in their elected leaders, and losing their homes before they'll start to look around and say, where do we go, what do we do? And even then, they won't know unless we have enough information out there to point this direction, to point this direction out to them. Because there really are no viable alternatives out there. It's back to God, or you know, back to the good old days, or law, civil law.
Or
so the job now, it's really critical to get this information out there while we still can.
I'll just add one more thing, and that's, someone brought this up last night, and it's completely in line with what you're describing, but it's another variation, is that Earth ships, mm-hmm. transition towns, yeah. these community things, these are might be needed in a very short-term sense as things start to continue to break down.
Transition towns.
Yeah. Exactly, which is, I have no disrespect for, but obviously they're not a solution. They probably recognize that.
Short-term solution.
Short-term solution, but what's going to happen is, if say we all got together and we started a nice community somewhere, say, I don't know, the number doesn't even matter, and it's outside the city of New York, say,
Sure.
And things start to break down, and we're doing great. We got our food grown, we're living decent.
Set up some chickens.
Know what's going to happen? Those people that are starving and displaced will come straight for whatever's working. That's just a natural tendency of any organism that's starving, and they'll do whatever they can. So unless you want to have men with automatic weapons at your gates, so it's important that people not try to find intermediate patchwork solutions. We don't have time for that. I have friends that are doing right now. They're going to places and they're growing their own food because they're so tired of being poisoned by industry, and they understand what's happening. But I try to explain to them that that's not a solution. We have to work together. There's nowhere to hide, in other words. So
I think that's sort of how I feel. I'm kind of caught in the middle, you know.
Sure.
I could at any time drop off the grid, you know.
Sure.
I can grow potatoes in my houseplants. I know how to do it.
Sure, yeah.
I know how to remediate any kind of
soil. And that's good information to have.
Yes.
I certainly don't put any of that down. But if we wanted to change, we have to change the society. There's no way around it, especially with the growing population. I couldn't sit back, say, in my own little community village and just watch the death of billions of people, right. Which I'm not saying is going to happen, but it's already slowly happening. And it can only get worse based on the outlook, the financial outlook, and everything that's happening with the scarcity that's being generated by this system.
How optimistic are you that we can do this?
It depends on what you define optimism. I think, as Jacques and Roxanne just pointed out, there's going to be a tremendous amount of suffering because, unfortunately, people are not really rational in any direct way. They have to feel the problem. They have to be hit with something. You can't just tell somebody that this is happening. And believe me, out of all the work I've done for the past few years and the things I bring up, you can't rationalize with somebody whose emotional identification is so strong with whatever idea that is fallacious. You have to wait for them to experience the problem. And that's an unfortunate
reality. What if they don't, because we're so far gone?
I think eventually they will, though.
Well, this is the question, is that, so are we, it's gonna, I think, and it sounds like from something you said last night, maybe you also think this way, it's gonna go one of two ways. It's either gonna completely collapse on its own, the thing, the system.
I can clarify that.
That's happening now.
It's happening now.
It's been happening for a long time.
But I guess what I'm saying is, like, will people do something before that in preparation, or will it just happen and then they're just all going to be standing
there? Most people are not going to have anything.
And most people, I don't think, are going to do anything.
No, they're going
to
until
I can only refer to the last depression.
Yeah.
The 29 crash. I remember the wealthy people that had yachts, had that yacht stacked with food. They were ready to leave the country. If they succeeded, pirates would form of other people, right, and they'd take their yachts away from them. You can't live to yourself anymore, only they don't realize it, even though they have guns on the boat. Once that happens, piracy is very hard to control. You generate thousands of people forming groups, invading co-op communities that don't want anything to do with the system, and they start co-op growth, and they're eating, so they will invade them. And if you have your own little farm, and you say, well, the hell with people, I'm growing my own chickens, I'm raising food for my family, they will invade your farms.
Right.
You can't live to yourself anymore. But knowing that will not cause people to come around and say, that's logical and reasonable. People are neither logical nor reasonable. They'll kill each other, take what they can, and form lots of gangs. I don't know whether we'll ever see the Venus Project. I don't know that. It depends on how many people can identify with it. They look to me and say, Jock, when will you build these new cities? I'd like to move in. I said, it depends on what you do and other people. We have no power. We can only point to a direction. The only direction that'll save society, as I understand it, is to share all the Earth's resources, to remove all the artificial boundaries that separate people, and to bring in a resource-based economy where we share resources. If this comes about where I can address the United Nations and point these things out, they're trying to set up a meeting to do that. If I can point out, if the nations join together now, before the collapse, the severe collapse, join together, share resources, they can maintain a degree of sustainability. Whenever people use the word sustainability, I say, for whom? The banks? Wall Street? Who do you want to sustain? If you want to sustain everybody, they're not interested. So they control the media, they control the press, the newspapers.
That's changing a lot, though.
Sure.
It's changing a lot, and I can see
it. It is. Well, we can see that.
You know, it's, I mean, they're also going to stop it, I know this. I know this for a fact. They are going to shut it down. You know, they're going to shut the show down. What we do,
sure,
they're not psyched. You know, what he does, they're just not psyched that people are aware. You know, people who are
believe me, I completely understand.
Saying, you know, this shit has got to go.
Think about the period, like when you grew up, Jacques, when all you ever got was a newspaper about how the world worked. Complete controlled media. You had no outlet to even no television. We've have a very different world, and they've been doing their best to figure out how to try and continue their positions of control, just as any government does.
They will. I mean, net neutrality will go. You know,
we'll see what happens. The only problem with that is that there's so much money being made on the internet
right now.
It interferes with commerce.
That's right, and this is exactly why somebody like Murdoch and Jobs have decided to create their own daily paper.
Sure.
This is exactly why this is happening.
Sure.
There's no other reason for the merger of these two assholes, really.
One thing I wanted to comment, though, I'm sorry to interrupt you, on the point of breakdown before I forget, is that a lot of people say, oh, well, when's the breakdown going to occur? I'm like, you've been living through the breakdown for at least 40 years. The onslaught of more diseases, the onslaught of more poverty, the onslaught of more, well, not necessarily more wars per se, but the anticipation of many more wars, the onslaught of resource depletion, the onslaught of virtually everything, every life support system going into decline. This is what it is, and people just keep saying to themselves, as I've said, that's the way it is. You know, we have more starving people on the planet than ever before, and that's only going to get worse. It can't possibly get better. With what's happening right now, there's more debt. The only thing that's magnified this now is the debt collapse. That's really because it brings it to an optimized focus that the public still had never would have thought of prior. And most people today still think we're going to recover. There isn't going to be an economic recovery from this point on if the monetary system game is adhered to. And that's what people need to understand
according
critically.
To America.
Well, globally, though, if the monetary system of the global market, which is what it is. I mean, the American philosophy is permeated. The virus of the cancer of capitalism has permeated the entire world. There's no one that can escape. Those that even claim to be socialist are just capitalists. I mean, to provide, say, free education, is someone's paying for it. It's still being paid for. There's still money at every facet of motivation in the system. And one small aside that I want to just throw out there, and this notion of sustainability, I read a book recently, and they used the term sustainable business. Mm-hmm. And it was the most comedic thing I'd ever heard. It was written by this very prominent, wealthy environmentalist, and he was trying to explain how business can be sustainable. How can you possibly have sustainability in a paradigm, in an approach, where you have organizations in competition with each other that can't produce anything of high quality because of the need to have cost efficiency and preserve market share and cut corners at all times? How can you have sustainability when all industries are out for themselves and they're only worried about the resources and everything that relates to them, and they have no symbiotic or synergistic relationship to anything else? How can you have sustainability when they're obviously polluting and keep polluting on some level or another because it's framed it's framed in the context of the establishment, which means they have to cut costs. Framed in the context of the monetary system, when they have to cut costs, so they can't possibly have output of efficiency, meaning you have to have landfills. No one can afford proper disposal. No one can afford to do all the things that are really necessary. No one can care about having sustainable goods, nor is it possible to have sustainable goods in order to keep the consumption going. So I laughed comedically when I was listening to this huge, reading this entire book on sustainable business, because it's completely relative. They make it a little bit more sustainable. They say, oh, we're going to recycle a few more things. His name is Hawken, Paul Hawken. He's a very famous economist slash ecologist. Economist might not be the right word. And I have a great deal of respect for him, but he's trapped in the system. He's also well-to-do in the system. Like many different people that have these type of opinions, they're like, I have a great deal of respect for many different people out there. I'm not going to actually name any names because it might be misconstrued, but they don't go far enough. A lot of people that are praised as activists in ecology, they go just to the edge of the monetary system, but they're so indoctrinated they think the monetary system is a given. It's presupposed, religiously ordained.
Well, they have ordained.
Mortgages and children. You know? They're literally invested in it,
but that doesn't mean that they can't acknowledge it. Everyone has to make money in this system, but it doesn't mean
like
you can't acknowledge it.
Take someone like Dixon Tebonier, who you featured in your Vertical Farming. He's a hero of mine. I love him.
Absolutely.
Think he's great. I've had many exchanges with him, and he's really very inspiring. And the work that he does and what he's done for a lifetime, dedicating his life to sort of the concept of vertical
absolutely
farming,
which is very
brilliant.
Yeah.
But all he's doing, you know, at every TED conference that I see him at, and I go to every single TED conference there is, and at every TED conference, all he's really looking for is an investor. You know, all he really wants is an investor to say, listen, let's convert Newark, the building in Newark, you know, let's try this. But, you know, he's not trying to profit. He is trying to feed the world. I mean, that's what he's trying to do.
I attempted to interview him. You're speaking to the individual at Columbia, right?
Dixon, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, Dixon. I tried to interview him, and he said, I'm sorry, I can't do any video interviews, film interviews, because Sting has the right for all of my video interviews. And
Sting,
I almost...
It's true.
But I thought to
that's
myself...
That's true.
I mean, I don't know if that's good or bad. I have no idea.
It's bad, but he had to take the money from Sting because he needed to continue doing his work.
And I understand.
His funding was
stifled. And I don't put him down for that, but it just goes to show the nature of the system and how it automatically blocks everything.
He'll meet you face-to-face. I mean,
sure.
You know,
you seem like a very nice guy. I'm not...
The
I'm
nicest
kidding.
Guy and
sure.
really a great thinker.
Sure,
know,
absolutely.
Thinker, but at some point, you know, in his research years when he was, you know, he hit a wall. And right. he had to keep going, and then there were these people who were, Sting is committed to...
Sure, I'm not putting down any of the characters, I'm just saying that it's unfortunate that the word can't continually be spread.
Sure.
Like, I could have had his stuff exposed to millions and millions of people, I sort of do, but if I was in it, it may be a little more powerful, you know, to know that we can produce organic...
Well, again, it's about joining forces. You know,
sure.
It's about inclusivity and not exclusivity.
Exactly. The monetary system confirms exclusivity.
Right.
And competitiveness.
And competitiveness, absolutely. And why Sting would restrict something like that is also problematic.
Well, that's Sting's ego.
Okay.
You know, that's like Sting's battalion of managers. I don't mind that.
I'm
saying this. So
I'll add that.
Okay. Anyway. Very good, though. I mean, I don't put down anyone in the sense of, as I understand the way that people operate in this system. Everyone does what they have to do, and I look at even the most vile company like Monsanto, as, in fact, just another example of the matter of degree of what this system creates. That's all they are. It's just a matter of degree. So I try to convince people that I talk to that they hone in on singular corporations. And by the way, I think that you need to be activist oriented against some of these
people. I
think
that all those corporations should be targets of
absolutely,
of
but you can't.
I mean,
you can't.
They should not be spared.
You cannot. But the only problem is that you have to make sure that the larger order point is always made, that these are products of a system and
the symptoms
exactly. So that's what I would say about that.
It's an endless battle when you pick out corporations like that and continuously try and stop that. You might get some legislation through, and then when the next government comes in, it'll revert right back. That's really not the solutions to the problems. We really need to advocate a total world global resource-based economy. And to the extent that we don't advocate that and work toward that, that will determine the amount of problems that we will have remaining.
When few nations control most of the Earth's resources, others will try to invade and get a piece of the cake.
Which is what's happening right now.
So you have no intelligent plans out there. The more intelligent, the higher the order of intelligence, meaning better management of the Earth's resources, the more difficult to reach people. People understand things like, it's our country, right or wrong, let's get out there and defend it. They'll join with that. Mm-hmm. But people say to me, Jock, every time I ask you a question, I get a lecture, not an answer. Because there are no answers. There's no simple answer. It's very involved. Mm-hmm. And the average person is not equipped to handle that. That's why I keep saying there'll be a lot of trouble ahead, a lot of assassinations, wild people, groups breaking windows. They don't know what else to do.
Right.
They don't know how to handle problems. Like in the Arab world, a guy may beat his wife 3 times a week to a pulp to get her to obey him. That's normal to that culture. They don't know anything else. Now, giving women equal rights is unthinkable in that type of culture. Do you understand? So you've got the scar tissue of hundreds of years in people, and you don't come out and one day say, oh, here's the answer, even if it were the answer. If they don't understand it, it's not the answer.
Right.
What they do is the answer.
Right.
And if they kill each other, which is what I think they will do, and there may be few people that can escape the system. All I can talk about is what happened during the Depression. There were many men sleeping in the winter over gratings, in front of hundreds of them, and that bothered Al Capone. And he opened the first soup kitchen. Said, you know that? More than the federal government. Was he evil in some areas? Yes. In other areas, no. So Al Capone started feeding people. And then the Italian Americans were feeding one another. And then the Jews pulled into their own corner. And the Irish were beaten up because during the potato famine, a lot of Irishmen came to America and they worked for one half the amount what Americans work for. So Americans said, those goddamn Irishmen, let's beat them up because they're taking our jobs away. The whole reason for aberrant behavior is fear of scarcity or unemployment. During the Depression, there was a factory that had signed Help Wanted, and I saw lines all around the block. And the guys would say, hey, let's get rid of that fat Jew, let's get rid of that Irishman, let's get rid of that Arab. But during the war, they wanted all the help they can get. They didn't care who was in line,
sure,
as long as there was jobs for everybody. So you're dealing with social chaos, and there's no clean line that people will follow. So whatever happens is real. What you think should happen is unreal. And that's what people get disappointed in. Not the world. Whatever the world does is real. Whatever happens is real. What you think should have happened disappoints you. H.G. Wells, in his book, The Shape of Things to Come, he died brokenhearted. He said, the world should be so far along, he suffered from his own projections. The world will do what it does, not what Fresco thinks is right, or Peter Joseph thinks is right. They will do whatever the hell they have to do to survive. Whether you'll see a saner world is highly improbable unless you begin to talk. All the people that come to these meetings, if they talk to other people and advise them in different directions, bear with them, stay with them until they understand. If everybody works at it, the transition will be less painful, not eliminated. Yeah. I'm sorry that I have this to say. I'd like to say I see glorious days ahead. That will please everybody, but it's not true.
I don't think it's so much that we're optimistic or pessimistic. I think we're really scared shitless as to what's happening and what's happening now and what the immediate future might bring. And we see a viable alternative that could eliminate a lot of suffering for a lot of people. So we're advocating it and asking other people to look into it and learn it and talk to others about it and get the information out there any way we can. Movies, books, radios, internet, while we still have the ability to do that.
Now, have you considered working with other movements? You know?
Well, people ask that question. There's some.
You know, there are so many.
They make a. Well, the thing is, I've yet to meet a movement, if you will, or an activist group that actually really identifies with the complete direction. And it's not to say that they are. Frankly, the one attribute that any organization that I think could possibly come in line with this, the one attribute they have to get definitively is the fact that the monetary system is the root of most of the problems, if not all the problems that we generally face on a severe level. That is it. And no, you know, Greenpeace, all the environmental organizations, they think that if they go after the corporations that they can influence, you know, even WikiLeaks is an interesting example because they're exposing. Always exposing. I hate to say it, and I said this last night. Months from now, no one's going to remember a damn thing.
That's not true.
Well, I think if they remember it, it's not going to change.
It won't
a damn
change
thing.
Anything, but he will have left some sort of indelible.
Oh, I agree with that.
You know,
let me rephrase that. I forget to say remember. Remember is not. There will be a fall of confidence, many different levels, because of those releases, which are viably so, but. The general consciousness of the public, general awareness of the public, it goes through them has there been any prosecutions because of that? Not that I've heard of. Has there been anything that has really culminated because of the really severe things that were revealed?
I mean,
in
the
those
only
cables?
Prosecution has been the one of Bradley Manning. That is it.
That's right.
So if there is a prosecution, there is a young man
in
who
the
is
other
in
direction.
A 12 by 10 jail cell. Right.
So and my point is that the. Goal here is to provide a solution, not to talk about problems anymore. I spent that time in Zeitgeist and even Zeitgeist Addendum. That's why I barely talk about, like, you know, I bring it up, like Wall Street and stuff, but it's not focused on as though I'm trying to, like, expose. I don't believe that's the route
but,
to do.
But don't you think that in the grand cosmology of things, that we're all connected and that we have our own part to play?
Well, of course.
Fit that puzzle, make it work?
Well, by all means, but I think my point is more of a central strategy, an effective strategy, and that is actually showing a new direction, not advocating, not constantly exposing. So back to my point about activist groups and other organizations, they're constantly harping on what they think is right and what right or ethical or what government should do in the sense that it's all contained within the system. It's never, what do they say about, you know, ecological organizations say we need to do this, this, and this. We need the money to do it. And they look for money. And that's what everyone essentially does. We need more funding so we can fight these fish loitering ships for Greenpeace. They frame everything in the system not knowing that the system itself is the problem. And what they also do is they create their own establishments. And this is something else I've run into with contacts of many organizations that I won't name. They see what we advocate. They have thousands of employees. Pseudo-volunteer employees. They still get paid. Many of these organizations that are nonprofit naturally still get paid. Nonprofit is just a subset of profit. It's just less profit is all it really means. So they're in a world where they're surviving off of their activism. And that's a big problem.
Careerism.
They have a career in fighting the problem. And there are some radio talk show hosts that advocate
that's
things
us.
That
I mean we're not, you know, even pretending. I mean, I'm surviving.
I just want to point that out for the sake of those that are listening.
I'm not.
That we create establishments, and the larger the establishment becomes, such as the global warming establishment, you know, such as the cancer establishment. Let's resolve cancer. You know how many trillions of dollars and how many thousands and thousands of people would be out of work if someone, and by the way, these resolutions do exist. I won't go into that. They've been around for decades, but they're completely ignored and they're prosecuted and the doctors are anyway, it's a long tangent. Anything they can do to stop the servicing problems is how things work, and it goes for the activist community as well. So these are the types of things that I hope any group, if any group realizes that, they say, we recognize the monetary system as the problem, then by all means, they can come in. And frankly, I hope they would just come in under the umbrella of the Zeitgeist movements. You don't have to worry about these two different organizations and people getting confused by different names. Right. You know, there, I could easily make a list of organizations that are in harmony with us, but within the movement. So you don't have like this abstract partnership and all these different, you know, it's an ego thing. You know, there are people that have already broken away from the Venus Project and the movement because they have their own ego. They're like, we're going to do our own thing. We don't like this aspect. And then, and it's so counterproductive. It's self-defeating.
That goes back to the cultural aspect. That's so hard to change. We're all conditioned to have that kind of ego mentality when we're right. pitted against each other for survival and we have to compete. It's only natural that everybody wants to glorify themselves or have their own independence and everything.
And importance.
So. That's what's been reinforced in this system since the moment they're born, is
it's
reinforced competition.
So
I think some it's a natural response in this system.
In the system.
It's not, not a human response.
Right, exactly. That's what I meant. Sure.
Some of our lessons may come from people. There are people on this earth that are just barely in this system.
Sure.
It does still exist. And so it's not maybe that they have the entire program as far developed as like what you're discussing. But let's say the Zapatistas, which are just people living in the jungle that don't want to hear about
sure.
the government systems, they don't want to hear about money, they don't want to hear about any of that shit.
Sure.
They just want to like all go about their lives. They're remarkably participatory in their governmental
right.
thing or whatever. Versus in Argentina, when their economy went down, and there's a question about the degree of collapse. Right? Mm-hmm. Because if it collapses somewhat, but a government can still pay its soldiers and its police, mm-hmm. that's one thing.
Sure.
If it collapses more, and they can when they cannot pay their policemen anymore, and they cannot pay their soldiers anymore, this is something else.
Well,
and you end up in a situation in Argentina where people were going back into the factories and reopening them on their own, just because it's like, there's resources all around me, I'm gonna go to work. You know, and
sure.
they get in these fights with the guy who thinks he owns the place from before,
right.
or whatever. But sometimes these, I think at an individual level, and in some of these other more far, I mean, I don't know how far flung Argentina is per se, but it's not New York City anyway, and it's not London.
Right.
You know, like, and they're coming from a different social upbringing and different culture, whatever.
Non-materialistic.
Let's say less materialistic.
Sure.
Well, I wouldn't say that.
I don't know about Argentina, but in
sure,
another
well,
example, there's
sure.
also interesting examples in the Soviet Union when it collapsed, where factories started these really elaborate barter chains, because
mm-hmm.
they didn't know what else to do.
Right.
So like one factory that made tires would call up somebody that made trucks and be like, can we give you tires? And then the people who made trucks would call the company that made sugar and be like, I don't know, do you need trucks? And they'd work out these elaborate barters.
One thing I'd like to point out is that the collapse that's happening now is extremely different than any collapses that have occurred because of financial purposes.
Yeah.
This is a resource collapse, coupled with a debt collapse, coupled with a pollution acceleration, coupled with a destabilization of the atmosphere and the climate. This is a amalgam of problems, both man-made in a sense of abstraction, like the monetary system, and what we've created as a result, the consequence of what we've been doing for so long. So even if the soldiers are paid, they're going to come home to
nothing.
To ravages. They're going to come home to lack of energy. They're going to come home to a depletion of food in many cases. So it's not going to work even if they keep printing more and more money. You know what I mean? So this is the big difference between what happened in the Great Depression. Great Depression, you know, there was plenty of resources. The fall of Argentina, and which was a credit expansion
yeah.
collapse. This is a completely new paradigm that we're entering into right now. So it's important to make that point.
In Zimbabwe or something. Like if your soldier's going home and he's being paid with $1 trillion bill.
it's a marvel.
It may break morale a little bit.
It's a marvel that it could even make it to $1 trillion bill in my mind. You know, someone's actually rationalized, no, we need $1 trillion bill. All right, let's do that one. I mean, you know what I mean? It's like, what the hell?
It's just to show how arbitrary it is.
It is, but the fact that they would even get that far blows my mind.
Well, he won't let go. There's ego for you.
Yeah, it's like.
Does the movement have any presence at all in East Asia or in China specifically?
China, no, not that I know of.
There's none of that.
You know, China. There are a few people. I've got a few emails from China. They've snuck through their internet system, evidently, and
ways.
As far as I know, there was a few people that were trying to do something, but there's no official chapter. And you know, there are other Asian countries that there we have a presence in. You can
Indonesia.
Go to. I think we have an Indonesian chapter.
Singapore.
Or a small one. We have Singapore. Yeah.
Singapore's huge.
We have to start somewhere.
Singapore's an ideal city, actually, to have a.
The major landmasses we don't have any real presence in is Russia. We have a Russian chapter, but it's not very active as of last I checked. And Russia's gigantic.
Right.
And then Africa, we have a South African chapter now, but again, it's a very small group, as you might imagine. And I guess that's dominant. Those are the two dominant landmasses. If you look at the maps of our chapters and the maps of Z-Day or the maps of this film. What's that?
As a continent, there's nothing on Antarctica.
That's true. We don't have to worry about that too much. The Eskimos, I don't think, need a resource-based economy. Are Eskimos in Antarctica?
No, they're Greenland.
Just
science.
It's a projection. I don't know anything about Antarctica.
I have something that I can say about the nature of the collapse and the transition. I think a lot of people have this notion that we're waiting to see this massive earthquake when suddenly everything stops. And overnight, everything is a disaster. I don't think we're ever really going to see that. Like you guys have been saying, and I agree, that we've been living in the collapse for the last 4 years. How many people are dying every day? How many homeless do we have? The transition is going to be the same thing. I don't think overnight we're going to suddenly have fresco cities all over the world. It's a sliding scale. And in order for that sliding scale to start sliding back up towards positive transition, we're going to need more and more people to wake up and realize that they have a choice, they can participate. Voltaire said that man is free the moment he chooses to be. So it's really up to us. I mean, the Venus Project has been around for how long? And the Zeitgeist movement has only been around for a few years, and we already have about 500,000 members or more.
It's been 2 years.
2 years, so that's a really short amount of time. Imagine what we could accomplish in another 2 years if that number doubled or tripled, and that's the point. That's how things are going to work if we have that critical mass.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And the Venus Project was 2 before that.
Right.
Was what?
Was 2 before that.
Oh, right.
Zeitgeist movement.
Yeah. But what are you not concerned about from the perspective of hard science? You know, we really are looking at a lot of solar activity. There is a lot of solar activity happening. The sun is emerging from an 11-year sleep cycle.
Okay.
Does that every 11 years, though.
It does it every 11 years, and we are looking at
it fries satellites every
large
11 years, too.
Solar storm that could wipe out the grid.
Well, that's a whole new level of concern.
Technology.
I'm not as familiar with that.
Sure. Well, you know what? This is all, as Jock poetically stated, that I always stay with me. The only problems that exist are the problems that affect the whole of humanity, in the sense of human problems.
Right.
And you know, we have no approaches holistically as a globe to resolve any global problems. I mean, that's a problem in and of itself that generates the need for a global system of some kind.
Right.
From that angle,
would that not be almost, I don't know, a nice segue into a future fresco city? You know, like for something like that to happen, you know, would that be?
I guess necessity creates action sometimes.
Sure.
Is maybe.
I'm not quite understanding your point, though. What would
if the grid went out?
If the grid went out.
Oh, right.
This has been happening. This isn't a new thing, and it's not a hypothetical thing. It happens every cycle. Like
every cycle.
Satellites get.
Interesting.
The Carrington event was the most famous incident, and it lit telegraph machines on fire.
Wow.
I mean, it happens.
Yeah, we have a lot more. We have a lot more for it.
And now we have more and more satellites.
More for it to sort of, you know, fry.
It's right. Going
to
be an interesting future.
It's backups. They're backups.
Well, they're trying, but so you know,
and that might be an excuse to shut down the activity because then only the essential commerce will be allowed. So I can see it being contrived and
all problems are used by the political establishment.
Exactly.
Never waste a crisis.
Yeah, absolutely. That's the first thing that all politicians, even news media, when they see any event, whether it's just for their self-interest on a shallow level, or you know. Or for something that they want to promote
rating
in their
levels.
Own extreme, yeah. Anything that happens, they try to orient it for their self-interest in whatever way they can. So that's to be expected. It's an important point for people to remember, especially every time we see any type of catastrophe. I won't even go into what's inspired the wars that we've seen and all of the press issues that come out. you know, with different individuals. Anyway, that's for another conversation. But
I think about the question about whether or not the grid collapsing would help move us towards a fresco city. It could or it couldn't. A collapse might speed that up, but it also might make it far more difficult now,
sure,
because we can't use technology
to
communicate. If the grid collapsed, how are people going to use the internet to communicate, which is one of our greatest assets right now, especially as a movement?
Well, I don't think the grid would collapse forever. I mean, it would be a collapse of,
I think
weeks.
What's...
Right. Something like that, but what would happen in those 3 or 4 weeks?
Sure, well... Yeah.
What are we really...
Sure,
that's hard to predict.
Anything can happen.
That's hard to predict. Like,
extremely hard to predict.
So we had an East Coast blackout a handful of years ago, right?
Yeah.
But it only lasted a day or two, so it was beautiful.
Yeah,
for the
great.
Most part, in New York
like
City,
New York
it was
City
considered
was
a holiday. It was like a holiday. It was beautiful. Mm-hmm. Everyone treated each other. I mean, it was really an indication of what humans would like to be with each other rather than like what the system tells them to be.
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
For that night, everybody was gorgeous.
It was a highlight
like
of my entire
ask anybody that was here in 2003 about their blackout experience. And some people had bad moments.
So much, there was a lot of love going on.
But there was a lot of love going on.
Love you.
And that was the overall instinct for most people.
Sure.
And so now, if the blackout had lasted 2 weeks,
mm-hmm. What are we looking at?
When everybody's blood sugar starts to kick in, like on the fifth day,
and
they run out of food, and suddenly people start to remember that they are armed, actually, and that, you know. So these aren't predictable things.
They're not. But they know something is not right. You know, they do.
I hope so.
Well, obviously they do. I mean, yes.
They do. I mean, which is why they spend all this money, like, you know, putting out the, you know, calling 311 and saying, pack your go bag,
sure,
get ready. You know,
sure.
This has got nothing to do with 9/11.
Right.
They don't give a shit. You know, they really don't. Like,
right.
they know that something else may happen,
right.
You know.
Right.
What that something else is, I don't know. I'm not clear on
you
that.
You know what Mark Twain said? That the Earth is the insane asylum of the universe.
That's great.
And so whether people do the right thing, they want change in you, not themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You want to change other people to see things their way.
Sure.
As long as U.S. thinks that way, Britain and France and Germany, you're going to have problems. If we get to more people in less time, and the people act, talk to other people, and we build a large enough following, we can influence the future. If we fail to do that, whatever happens will happen. That's the way I see it.
Can you draw a distinction between when we're talking about global solutions, right? There's one set of people, I think, at a more citizen level who agree and who think that, like, we're all in this together. We have to think about it this way. We have to find mutual solutions. It's a very mutual aid kind of mindset.
Sure.
So how do you talk to the people who talk about black helicopters and the one world government and all of that? Set
Alan
of fears
of
about
yeah.
You can't let there be a global system because, according to
the level,
fear set.
The level of I can't think of a word to describe the ignorance and mind lock and religious faith and
religious
fear that people have of the world trying to work together.
Yeah.
And that somehow you're going to end up with the grand world dictator that has everyone on leather leashes.
That's the Pope.
and it blows my mind. I get emails about this all the time, and if anyone's familiar with the feedback of Zeitgeist Addendum, there have been media critics that have brought this up as though we're advocating some kind of new tyrannical one world government. You might remember in the early editions of Zeitgeist the movie, I talk about how the banking system had been planning on making a unified banking orientation, which is essentially one world government, because government really is the movement of money.
Yeah.
And they already have this.
Sure.
It's been around, and it's called the New World Order. But that label is contrived. The New World Order definition has changed throughout time. Mm-hmm. It was first introduced by H.G. Wells in his book, The New World Order, which was actually a positive book that was completely misinterpreted by people that thought he was talking about eugenics and controlling people and microchipping them and all of these things that were basically invented out of thin air with regards to what his intentions were. And then it got morphed, and then it got used by different famous personalities throughout time.
Trickle down.
And then now we have this psychotic, weird group of religious fanatics, not necessarily of a Christian or anything.
No,
they're religious in their blind view of this fear. And that's a big problem. I don't know what to say when I want, because you can't rationalize.
You can't rationalize because it's not irrational.
If anyone can't realize that the world is a singular system, and that people share all the resources, and it's completely interrelated synergistically, and that there are global problems as it is a singular system, if they can't realize that humanity is a has to work together, if one group has this, another group doesn't, then they're going to fight. That's just the way it's always been historically, and that's just the way we respond to scarcity and deprivation. If people can't get that under their belts, I don't know what to say. You know, you just have to walk away when people bring that stuff up, you know? But I've actually been called a one-worlder.
They're the greatest attractors, though, to the work that people are trying to do. It's actually really frustrating.
It is. Yeah, I understand the fear of power, because we have been abused by power for years. And I can understand that, but it doesn't reconcile the necessity to be organized. We have to get through this power neuroses, and the power neuroses is generated by the tradition of the system and the monetary
self-interest.
And the tradition
of the hierarchy, pyramid type structure versus,
right. Or you abuse,
versus a collaborative,
where you abuse everyone at the bottom. Precisely, system. You abuse everyone at the bottom for the sake of the people at the top. Yeah. Such as now today,
we have the Illuminati triangle.
Well, you want to call it that, but the triangle has been around for a long time. In that sense, it's, you have 1% of the population owning 40% of the planet's wealth, making all their money off of essentially the slavery of the entire.
Pick a pharaoh, pick a king, whatever.
It's exactly the same.
Exactly.
It's just a variation, a little bit better. Mm. And it's hidden in America.
Subtle.
People actually think they're free because they've been told they're free. They think they have democracy.
I think it's blatant.
Yeah, but people can choose to tell themselves whatever they want.
They can condition themselves. I'm sure there's people.
This is what I was saying.
It's Stockholm
syndrome.
In the hallway.
It's Stockholm syndrome.
It
when somebody's been in a bad relationship for a long time, and they've been putting up with like awfulness from the other person for a long time, I bet they have a justification for it.
Oh, they work.
They've come up with a way to rationalize it to themselves, sure. And to their friends and whoever hears them talk about it.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, why did you put up with all that, right?
Sure.
And people do that with everything.
They do
that with their government. They
justify.
Do that with their
constantly justify.
Come up with a way to